editor of The Economist and Political Weekly, but I think as one of Monomashi's many nephews. For this occasion, I've penned a few thoughts which I'd like to share with you. I knew Lothika Sarkar from the mid-1970s, but my relationship with her was entirely personal. I never worked with her at the Department of Law of Delhi University, or the Law Institute, or the Center for Women's Development Studies in Delhi. I never participated in any of her campaigns, and I was never associated with her on any projects. However, over the course of 4 decades, we were first family friends with Lothika and Chanchal Sarkar. Then, Mashi, as I called Lothika Sarkar, she was my first and last Bengali aunt. And Mesho, as I called Chanchal, and I formed an extremely close and special friendship that lasted time, distance, and bridged a generation. I first got to know Mashi in Delhi in the summer of 1976. It was a typically oppressive North Indian summer. It was doubly so that year because we were entering the second year of the emergency. My parents had moved the previous year to Delhi, and my father was now in Tihar jail for campaigning against the emergency. My mother was by herself, for I was fortunate to get a job in Delhi and be with her and near my father. We were still new to the city and now completely alone in Sanjay and Indira Gandhi's New Delhi. It is difficult now to convey the oppression of the emergency days. If you are under watch by the government, then your friends shun you and your relatives abandon you. The fear of those days was extreme. We were alone except for Mashi and Mesho, who were our neighbors and already friends. They did not fear Mrs. Gandhi and were a source of immense support and cast a protective shield around my mother and me over the next year. I would not hesitate to say that were it not for Mashi and Mesho, and I must add, Mr. George Burgess, journalist, and one cousin of mine, we may not have survived that year before the emergency was lifted. Those bonds between our families only grew stronger over the decades, even after first my parents and then I left Delhi. For me personally, it was the beginning of a friendship that I always treasured. I was less than half Mashi's age when I first met her. She showered me with immense affection, but no more or no less than she gave her legions of nephews and nieces. But she always made each one of us feel special. She would treat you as an equal, but would not hesitate to berate you if you acted foolishly. You could go to her and consult her on your work, or, as many of us youngsters did, on the matters of the heart as well. She would have time for everything, and that is how I think this friendship between an aunt and nephew grew into a close relationship that continued until last month. I can recall from the mid-70s and from later as well, literally sitting at her feet and listening to her talk. She would sit on her divan with legs curled up and stylishly smoke a cigarette as she shared her vodka or gin or whatever it was that evening, and speak about her work with the Committee for Protection of Women, about her statements at the Delhi University and more. I was glad that as recently as 2011, I was able to kind of relive those evenings. We went out one evening for a short dinner in Delhi and enjoyed a gin and tonic and a fish fillet. Something I teased her that she was not getting at Usha's and Murli's place in Delhi. We went out together once more in May 2012, but by then it was clearly a huge effort for her to walk a few steps, and she was relieved to get back home quickly. To go back to Delhi of the 1980s and thereafter, I would see Mashi every time I was in Delhi and get to hear her talk about the Mathura rape case, the CWDS and the Law Institute. I was proud to tell everyone that my friend, philosopher and guide was this extraordinary professor of law at the Delhi University. I was not alone in this friendship that Chanchal and Lothika Sarkar had with young people. Their house in the 1970s and 80s was an open one, especially for the young, and especially those from small towns in UP and Bihar. I remember the many young people who came to Delhi to prepare for the civil services, and who were hosted for a while at L1x10 house class, that was their home. I would help to find accommodation as they prepared for those tough exams in an alien city. At least a couple of them were even helped with finding jobs when they did not make it to the civil services. This was the other side of Maharshi and Meshwar, the other side of this feminist scholar and this journalist. Of course, some of us disappointed Maharshi and Meshwar. I know of at least two who took almost criminal advantage of their generosity. And later, we sadly came to see how Maharshi was treated badly by one of those he and Meshwar had helped so much when he was in his 20s. But a little bit of that immense amount she gave to others did come back. I want to use this occasion to thank Meetu Alur, Malavika Karlekar, Usha Ramanathan, and many others for being with her at one of her most difficult times, when this extraordinarily fine person was literally deprived of her home and all her savings. And through it all, she never lost her smile or her warmth. I last met her in September or October last year. I was in Delhi with my 10-year-old son and wanted very much for him to meet this wonderful person who was so important for me. Sadly, by then, Maharshi no longer recognized me. But that did not matter. Typically, even for those 10-15 minutes, she was all smiles and bright eyes for both of us. That is how I will always remember. And as Meetu Alur said, it has been a privilege to have known her and interacted with her over the decades. Thank you.